Okay, we're gonna start our second panel, which is about voter engagement and, this is that title, voter education and engagement, reaching all voter New Yorkers, and this panel will be moderated in the absence of our director of voter assistance, Ramita Palomares. It will be moderated by Sabrina Juarez, who is our, in the voter assistance unit, the voter assistance project liaison.
Welcome back, everybody. My name is Sabrina Juarez, and I'm from Voter Assistance, as Amy mentioned. And I am filling in for Anita Coward, Mayor's Director of Voter Assistance. I am very happy to be here with you, and she's brought me up to speed, so I have all of her notes, something to worry about. And wanted to let you know that today we will be discussing voter engagement and education. We have a great panel lined up to discuss the CFP's voter education and engagement efforts through NYC vote programs in the 2013 election. And joining us today is Kate Dorn. Representing the League of Women Voters. She's an election specialist and has also worked as a poll site coordinator in Park Slope. And David Pollock.
You have to talk into it.
That's better?
Yeah.
Okay. And David Pollack, Associate Executive Director and Director of Government Relations and Security for the Jewish Community Relations Council. Welcome. At this moment, I would like to read to you the CFE voter engagement efforts during the 2013 municipal election. Okay. I wanted to set the stage for the CFE's, as the CFE's has was engaged through voter engagement. Can you hear me?
No.
Really?
Is that one working?
Hello. Yes, okay. Talk into it.
That close.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. I want to set the stage just a bit. The CFE's mandate grew significantly this cycle with the 2010 City Charter Amendment that created the Voter Assistance Advisory Committee within Campaign Finance Board. In 2013, the CFE relaunched its voter education campaign, NYC Votes. We adopted a new logo and committed to a cross-platform approach to make sure NYC Votes reach voters at every available medium. Our campaign featured the multimedia voter guide, the debate program for citywide candidates, a new mobile app, and voter outreach efforts coordinated with public and private partners. First, every candidate on the ballot was permitted to participate in our print and video voter guide versions. The CFE mailed nearly 7.5 million printed voter guides in five different languages: English, Spanish, Chinese, Korean, and for the first time, Bengali. The online voter guide provided vital information to tens of thousands of New Yorkers in the days leading up to the primary and general election. The CFE produced the city's video voter guide for the first time in 2013. The entire guide was broadcast on NYC TV. We feature the candidate videos on the online voter guide, the new mobile app, and our YouTube channel. YouTube says these videos were viewed more than 29,000 times and viewers watched more than 550 hours of video. The CFE launched a mobile app, nycvotes.org, to give voters a way to learn about the candidates and other voting information on their smartphones. Perhaps the most exciting feature, the app also allowed voters to contribute directly to candidates. As it has done since 1997, the CFE has administered the citywide debate program. The debates are mandatory for any candidate for mayor, public advocate, and controller who participate in the public matching funds program. Candidates must appear on the ballot and meet certain objectives and nonpartisan criteria to be eligible. This election year, the CFE held 12 debates for the three citywide offices, six for mayor, three for public advocate, and three for controller. Each debate was produced and broadcast live, simulcast in Spanish, and streamed online. The CFE worked closely with dozens of city agencies, nonprofits, and corporate partners to help New Yorkers register to vote, get ready for the election. Through these programs, from National Voter Registration Day to the Youth Poet Laureate Program, to attending naturalization ceremonies, NYC Votes personally reached thousands of New Yorkers. Finally, the CFB launched a comprehensive social media campaign on Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. We asked New Yorkers to get ready for the election and to make sure their friends and neighbors were ready too. The social media campaign launched over the summer with a design concept of I voted stickers and culminated on primary and general election days when we worked with the Board of Elections and our community partners to distribute these stickers for the voters across the city. So as you can see, it was a very busy year. At this moment, I would like to let our panels read their testimonies. They have prepared written testimony, and we can start with Kate.
Good morning. Thank you very much for inviting me. I don't know if you realize that I'm a stand-in for our board member emeritus, Laura Altshuler, who is the lead author of this testimony. And it's going to have a more general slant because we didn't realize that we were going to be invited to be on this particular panel. So, the League of Women Voters has been a staunch supporter and advocate for public campaign financing for decades. The League of Women Voters has been a staunch supporter and advocate for public campaign financing for decades, and we congratulate you on your work over these past 25 years and the debate program encompassing 4 citywide elections. We have testified after each cycle, and every 4 years you have improved the technology and information available to the public and the candidates. Particularly useful was the ease with which one could determine contributors and recipients' independent spending by newly formed organizations, even allowing voters to make small contributions on their cell phones. Problems with matching funds in 2005 and 2009 for candidates who were not in a viable contest or using funds to pay relatives appear to have been corrected. We support your strong statements regarding the Citizens United Supreme Court decision, as well as opposing the funding from unknown sources or organizations formed to oppose candidates. We believe independent spending merits continued scrutiny and analysis to identify any abuses which could undermine our campaign finance program. We are also concerned about the implications of candidates receiving contributions for activities outside of the immediate campaign cycle, for debt from prior cycles, transition, or inauguration expenses. Are these contributions monitored by the Campaign Finance Board? Are they eligible for matching funds? Are all of these electeds entitled to transition funds, even if they are re-elected to the same office? The League of Women Voters' positions support a fair playing field for all candidates, so that wealth alone does not determine who will win an election, and every candidate has the right to defend himself or herself against charges which have not been proven. That is why we questioned the Campaign Finance Board's decision to stop all matching funds for John Liu at a time when it was established that approximately $20,000 was collected illegally by 2 of his campaign workers. To this day, John Liu has not been charged, indicted, or tried for any campaign violation. Unless you had additional information that was not made public as to why all funds were withheld from this campaign, it gives the public the impression that the CFB removed Mr. Liu from the ballot. We believe that the choice should have been left to the voters. The League of Women Voters of the City of New York has made voter information its mission for 95 years. With current technology, we were able to link your excellent voter guide to our website, which also included the almost forgotten 6 ballot proposals. The League and its partners WABC-TV and Univision were included as a debate sponsor for the Campaign Finance Board's first 3 citywide election cycles. And we continue to believe that the number of campaign mailings, TV, and cable ads the voters are best served by unfiltered primetime debates with relevant questions and sufficient time for candidates to respond. Unfortunately, despite more debates, more online and print information available 24 hours a day, the turnout on election day was very poor. The League, other civic organizations, and the Campaign Finance Board provided the information, and yet the majority of eligible voters stayed away from the polls. Some who did go were given incorrect information or found the ballot with that 6-point font difficult to read. We believe that more must be done to facilitate and encourage increased voter participation. We urge the Campaign Finance Board to join us in supporting a June primary for all elections, state and federal. While New York State must comply with the MOVE Act for federal elections, 3 statewide elections in 4 months is confusing to voters and very costly to the city because it is our budget, as you know, which covers all election costs. We also hope the Campaign Finance Board will join us in supporting instant runoff voting for the primaries where we may select the candidates for citywide offices. While we are more than 3 years away from these elections, it's important that any change in the way we vote be enacted as soon as possible so that we have ample time to educate voters and encourage their participation. Implementing instant runoff voting would also obviate the need for a second costly primary, which traditionally has a very low turnout. Congratulate and welcome Rose Gilhern, your new chair, and we look forward to working with you in the years ahead. Thank you very much.
David?
Thank you. Welcome, Madam Chairman and Chairwoman, our chair. And thank you for inviting me. Sometimes democracy can be depressing. The voter turnout last year was last fall was abysmal. 22% of the enrolled Democrats voted in the primary election, and 23.5% of the registered voters in the general. Some eligible people could not vote, but most affirmatively decided to stay away from the polls. We must do better. And despite all of the great efforts that that this body has done, we must do better. There's a concept in voter behavior known as voter efficacy. Do voters feel that those in power care about people like them? And do those in power want to hear their voice? Historically, improved voter efficacy benchmarks positively correlate with increased voter turnout. One proven path to higher voter efficacy is voter education. So we're on the right track here. We believe that through the board's outreach efforts, its voter guides and debates during the past campaign season, the New York City Campaign Finance Board did an outstanding job furthering voter education. As I understand it, the objective of this hearing is to explore ways to improve the already outstanding existing outreach efforts. We in the Jewish Community Relations Council had a very specific problem, and that is we dealt with an immigrant community, the Russian speakers. They're no different than anyone else. They come from a different culture. And it should be noted that in the former Soviet Union, everyone had to vote, so voter turnout was in the 90s, but they understood that their vote meant nothing. Here, we have to educate this community that the opposite is true. They're totally free to vote or not to vote, but their vote does mean something. And we've, since 2004, we've engaged in very specific efforts to work with this community, to teach them the process, to teach them about civics. You know, those of us who were educated here, you know, learn civics. They didn't. The citizenship process doesn't necessarily do it. So we've done that. But many of the leaders of the Russian-speaking community came to us and said, we don't think we belong. When we go to the polls, there are no translated materials. When we go to the Campaign Finance Board, there's nothing available in Russian language. And this is a very natural problem. The Board of Elections and the Campaign Finance Board follow the guidelines of the voter rights, the Voting Rights Act, Section 5, and follow the requirements of language assistance. Now, we came to the staff of the Campaign Finance Board, and they were immediately receptive. We understand that you have a problem, but truth be told, the board doesn't have a budget to translate its materials into the languages that would be appropriate. So we came up with a bold counterproposal. It was probably not only bold, but foolhardy. We said, we will produce a parallel Russian language set of materials to your materials. And it didn't cost a lot of money, it just cost us, those of us, my colleagues on the JCRC staff, a lot of time asleep and over, working at night and we over the nights and weekends. We did come up with something. Your staff was phenomenal because they didn't want to trust, and they shouldn't, that we came up with honest translations, things that really effectively paralleled your work. And so you have Russian-speaking staff people who read everything that we did, came back to us with comments. We had problems, and we had to come up with ways to solve them. The best example that I have is that, you know, your policy was to print exactly what the candidates gave to you, unedited. Well, how do you translate something if it doesn't make sense? So one candidate wrote, as an example, that all the only issue facing New York is the environment. All other issues are MUTE. So do we translate that as moot or mute? So we had to make decisions. We try to honestly maintain your decisions, and we came out with a very good product, which you felt very confident putting up on your website, so that when people clicked and they wanted translations, they found a translation in Russian. And we were glad to work with you. This was a significant undertaking. Despite your support, the work was worthwhile. Scores of people relayed their gratitude. The typical reactions were, I finally feel that they want my vote. And I feel like the Russian-speaking community is finally part of America. That's voter efficacy. And we saw notable jumps in voter registration in heavily Russian-speaking neighborhoods. So based on our experience, we have three recommendations. Number one, we think that the New York City Campaign Finance Board should comply with New York City's Campaign Language Access Policy. We've long advocated to the Board of Elections and the Campaign Finance Board to publish materials at least in the top six languages spoken by New Yorkers as required by Executive Order 120 for any other city agency. Now, we're not a mayoral agency, that's true. We believe that you should fill in those languages not mandated by the Voting Rights Act. This year, you published something in Bengali. There are 10 times as many Russian speakers as Bengali speakers in New York City. There are 15 times as many Haitian Creole speakers as Bengali speakers. You shouldn't ignore the Bengali speakers, but we should be addressing New York City as it is, not language issues that were written into the Voting Rights Act in 1982. We know well that New York City's diversity is dynamic, and the history of New York City reflects and celebrates the continuously evolving demographic snapshots. The languages can be determined by an examination of the latest appropriate ACS census data. The mayor's office should fund the Campaign Finance Board to do this. We understand you can't do this without appropriate resources. Number two, continue your efforts to be published. We were very effective. We did not make hard copies of our materials. We got the word out through our networks, and we started a viral campaign within the Russian-speaking community so that they knew that these materials were available. We think that printing and mailing costs are huge, and you should start thinking about the efficacy of printing and mailing. We suggest that content be inexpensively distributed through the internet, social media, and apps. You've started a terrific move forward through these outlets. I want to commend the League of Women Voters, and Steve Romulski is here somewhere. They did a phenomenal job where you pick up your phone and you know exactly who your elected official is, because it uses the GPS on your phone to know where you are. So it knows what district you're in. Again, I want to do a shout out to the chairman of the JCRC Commission on Public Policy, Professor Esther Fuchs, who did another wonderful site, who's on the ballot, accessing those, again, helping people know all of the issues in a clean, straightforward fashion. Sometimes too much information is counterproductive, and people just don't know where to start. Finally, number three, use the resources of the city for outreach. For example, we know we work very closely with the mayor's office of community affairs and the mayor's office of immigrant affairs, the NYPD. All of these agencies have networks of organizations. They know, what about houses of worship, community centers, senior centers? How do we reach out to those, deputize the leaders of those entities, and say, how many copies of the voter's guide do you need, and in what languages, so we don't have to pay for mailing? Those are the kinds of things I think we should be exploring to make ourselves more effective and really bring up the voter turnout in New York City. Thank you.
Thank you for your thoughts. So I'm going to start with David with a few questions, and then we'll go on to Kate. As you mentioned, David, your organization reached out to us to provide a printed voter guide in Russian and to better engage that community. And from what your testimony says, you believe it was successful, right? And would you do it again?
I would rather not, but we probably would.
And not everybody would be able to do what you did, and I think that this is a wonderful example of how community partnerships work. And the question is, how do you think that we can better partner with communities and with community partners who are in communities where English is not their primary language?
I think that there are that the city knows how to do this. You know, unfortunately, now the city has a new learning curve because we have a new administration. But you know, just as an example, NYPD has community affairs officers. They have community councils. How do we attend a meeting of the community council to find out what kind of information is available, is necessary? How do we use mapping? I can tell you where there are pockets of Jewish voters in New York very easily. I have those maps on my computer. I can tell you where the Russian speakers are. I can tell you where the Urdu speakers are and any others, because the Census Bureau has those. Why don't we do overlays and figure out how do we go where the voters are and serve them as best we can?
And what do you think?
Use a microphone, please. It's still not picking up.
Can you hear me now?
We're back, thanks.
Okay. What do you think the CFB could do better in to improve voter outreach efforts? I know you used the guide and you mentioned social media. What are some other efforts? And you mentioned some of the community partners. Is there something else that
I think those are the real key ways to do it. If you get into using ethnic media, it's ethnic media can be effective, but it also is expensive. And it might be, you know, just, I know that when we do a press conference for the Russian media, we have probably 20 outlets represented around the table when we do that. And placing ads in the, you know, and I had, in 2004, I got some funding to do outreach. And we did a very effective campaign, and we spent our money very wisely. We leveraged all kinds of funds, but it cost about $50,000 to do a good campaign just in Russian. And that's only a quarter million of the New Yorkers. You know, what about every other significant language group?
Kate, I'll start with you. I know that you spoke with Anita, and she mentioned to me that you came to the conclusion that registering the public is one challenge, but getting voters out to the polls is another challenge, and how important that is. So what are your thoughts on the NYC Votes tools to engage voters?
Well, I think I mentioned to Almeida that I'm a print gal still, and I love your voter guide, and we link to it on our website, and we also have an excellent way of reaching voters called Vote 411, which is totally nonpartisan, and we rely on candidates to provide statements to us, but we make those available to voters too. Who come to us and are looking for the names and information about the voters, about the candidates who are running for office in their areas. This is the big elephant in the room. How do we turn this thing around, this absolutely awful voter turnout that we're faced with? No simple answers, and I believe that it's really important. We're very grateful that you're talking about this today, and I think nobody should stop talking about it. We are willing to be part of any task force that you can think of, to that you might organize to help think about that. And we see a serious problem in that there is no civics education anymore, no real civics education in the New York City public school system. There's, in the fourth grade, they teach New York State history, and I believe there's some government, federal government requirement to teach about the federal government in middle schools, maybe in high school. But we believe that civics education has to start in the very young grades and continue all the way through. We also think that generations have been lost in teacher education, and that there ought to be in New York City, in teacher colleges, particularly for the social studies teachers, curriculum that will give them the resources they need to teach civics education in the class. Young people, as you know, are voters we try to target. They are some of the ones who are least likely to turn out. And we think that a habit and tradition of voting starts young, and there will be interest in voting if the civics education happens in the schools, and the kids, for example, understand who decides that there is a speed camera on my corner where it's dangerous? We know, because we're high information voters in this room, that that's something that has to be tackled by, or has to be legislated by Albany. How many school kids would know that?
On that point, I don't know. I bet that many of the people in this room did exactly what I did when my son was young. And he came into the poll with me when he was still a toddler, and he pushed the buttons. And he knows that he has to vote. He's now a junior in college, but he knows that he has to be a voter because it's important. And we plan for that. We can't expect everyone to plan for that. But one idea that I just came up with listening to you and your questions goes to the idea of civics. And how do we figure out, how do we give people more information? Can we, for example, partner with CUNY and CUNY Television to produce mini civics episodes that you can have on your website, CUNY can have on its website, which illustrates the, you know, how they can make a difference, how people can make a difference through their votes, how politicians look at how they vote. When I come up with when I use a map, I created maps that the Times eventually did, talking about, you know, block by block, who votes and what the vote is block by block. People are shocked when they know, when they find out, you mean my voting machine, it was 700 to 600 or whatever the vote was. People are shocked to know that politicians really look at this. And their vote does make a difference in how do we teach them. And maybe using some of these off years, maybe going after some foundation money, we could help do little mini episodes on YouTube or whatever. You know, using professors, using good people, keeping this.
Good idea. How do you think people would react? I mean, I know that I realize that when I have my cell phone, I'll get an amber alert. It'll just buzz, it'll say amber alert. How do you think people would react if there was a broader than we have the capability of doing now, alerts, you know, this is the day to register. You know, register these 3 days. This is election day. This is primary day. Do you think people would be offended by that? Or do you think that you know, because there is, again, I didn't sign up for the Amber Alert. It just comes. And, you know, my phone starts to go crazy. How do you think people would react to that?
Well, I don't think it could hurt. We should try it. I remember in my own, I have a personal anecdote. I knew of a young woman who wanted to vote in the 2012 presidential election. And I, of course, said, you have to be registered before you can vote. You have to be registered. And I volunteered to bring her a voter registration form. And she demurred. And then finally, she says, well, I want to register. And I said, it's too late. So, I mean, that's a young person who probably would have responded to an alert on her phone. So this is, we've got 3 days left to register, 2 days, whatever. But still then, registering is one thing and
getting people. And then you have to, you know, do it on election day.
I think it's a good idea.
The Amber Alert is, there's some legal issues there.
But
let's start with what we can do very easily, what we can bite off. Both the Office of Emergency Management and the NYPD have huge, huge notification lists. I am sure the mayor's office could make those available for a finite number of blasts. On, you know, last day of registration is next week. here's the link for the registration form. You know, you have 4 more days, 3 more days. I think that we could probably do that. That's doable, and it would make a difference.
Yeah, I always thought that early voting, that's one of the would be, I mean, in addition to making it easier, I mean, I think early voting actually is one of the big benefits of that is that you have, if you forget that today is election day, and if there are 4 days to vote, then you have 4 days to, you know, to catch up on your mistake, you know. So it's like, you know, just adds the amount of time that you can give people notice, you know, because sometimes people just get busy and forget. And so if you had more early, if you had early voting, you'd be able to allow people to have that, you know.
I think it's a wonderful idea, but I served about a century ago in 1985 on the task force to reform the Board of Elections. And one thing I learned is that most of the people in control of elections don't want a lot of voters. They want the voters they control, so that they can turn out. So I'm skeptical that we're gonna have any major change, just as the legislature is still debating whether to have our primary this year in the in May, June, or August, or September.
I'm just going to leave with one final note here. As Kate mentioned, we are high informed voters in this room, but this information has to get out to the communities, and it's those communities who receive these tools, both online, on the mobile app, on a print guide, and so forth. So looking through the lens of our users, how would you rate the program's effectiveness of our tools, starting from here? Both the voter guides, the online version, the mobile app version, and the
Well, we really congratulate you for expanding all the different ways that voters can get information. It's fabulous. I mean, but people, potential voters, need to want that information. And that's the problem. I love this new phrase, voter efficacy.
Very old phrase.
Yeah, well, I've been hearing it for the first time. But that requires a motivated voter. There's so much on an individual's computer and on their smartphone. They have to want that information. If they want it, it's out there, and they'll become a high information voter. But I don't know, I don't have the answer to how to translate that availability of information into a walk to the polls.
I think that you know, one of the issues is how do we put this onto someone's priority list, voting onto someone's priority list.
Right.
And I don't, you know, sometimes, I'm not sure the debates were watched. You know, I would love to see the ratings on the debates. I don't know, you know, if they're really worth the effort. I don't know if there's another way that we can deliver through TV the information in a better form. One of the reasons some people like debates is that they're unfiltered. And, you know, you have a very specific power, which is wonderful. I know that the JCRC tried to do a mayoral forum this year, and one of the candidates didn't want any forums. And that's often the case, that it's not in one candidate or the other's interest to promote, even, you know, the opposition being thought of as a reasonable alternative because they're so far ahead. You have the power to compel the candidates to participate. Is there a better way to do it? I'm not sure, but I am sure that there's a whole list of political consultants out there who might be able to feed in some ideas. Because they're the people who have spent millions of dollars figuring out how to craft messages. And how can we do that in a nonpartisan, even-handed way? That's the challenge.
Thank you. At this point, I'd like to open any questions to the floor. Thank you.
Thank you. My name's Mary Jenkins. I'm co-president of the League of Women Voters. And some wonderful ideas have been put forth. I'd just like to briefly mention some of the things that we've done over time. And we have a very active committee on campaign finance reform at the state level. We also, as Kate mentioned, have Vote 411 and Who Represents Me on our website. We, in the run-up to the city elections, we partnered with MNN and had debates for city council. We also partnered with Bronx Community College and had a debate citywide with candidates for mayor there. And also with ABC TV, which was the first debate that was presented and I think had the highest viewership. We also had a really great National Voter Registration Day event in Bryant Park. And of course we have a print, They Represent You, which we put out in 2013, and we're working on the 2014 version. And we have our telephone information answering service where people can actually talk to a person and find out where their voting place is, etc. But the question is still hanging, what can we do to get better turnout, but better voter participation? And I like the idea of the CUNY TV, partnering with CUNY and having civics episode. And as a retired New York City school supervisor, though, I know that if we want students to get civics, which is a part of the state standards in all the school, you know, elementary, junior high, and high school. But the emphasis is always on what is going to be tested. So if we can figure out a way to get the Department of Education to have high stakes testing on civics, maybe then we'll be able to get more done in that area. So I like the idea of the mobile app. I haven't seen it. I'd like to get more familiar with it. And Sabrina and Onita and I and several people from the league met recently, and we're hoping to have some cooperation in getting into the high schools and helping students register to vote and giving them a few civics lessons. So that's kind of where we are with that, and we'll keep on plugging away and doing the best we can. And I think the idea of partnering with local organizations is really critical in getting out into all the boroughs. And no one organization has all the resources to do this, but by partnering together, I think that we can really do a lot more. So my question is, what other organizations have you been partnering with lately?
Oh, on our part, with voter assistance, well, as David mentioned, the agencies do have a lot of resources. So we do work with a lot of the, I don't know if you can hear me, we do work with other agencies and do use their resources to distribute both the tools and create unique plans and programs for each one of them. So aside from the League of Women Voters, we work with both community and corporate. Some corporate are JPMorgan Chase and Popular Community Bank. But this year, they put the voting deadlines for registration and upcoming election dates, important dates, on their ATM machines, which was really helpful. We worked with DYCD, which helped our interns do a program while the students who were part of the Youth Summer employment program went to the orientations. We did voter registration and workshops there with our youth voter coordinator, and we registered about over 1,600 students just within 2 weeks, new voters. So we do work with a lot of different agencies and community partnerships. Currently, we have about over 100 community partners that partner with us, starting from the NAACP over to high schools and agencies, corporate partners, and community-based and faith-based organizations. So we are looking forward to this year, and we're starting to build that. And you know, we can always create unique plans to work with you, just like we met with the League of Women Voters not too long ago, and we're starting to do that as well. Thank you.
Yes, my name is Jensen Nick.
Oh, sorry. I observed that, I was a candidate for the 45th district. So I observed that we did have 12 debates and 3 for citywide. So we did not include the city council. In order to improve that, to improve the participation, we need more people to, obviously, to expose the candidates, like also, I like what David was suggesting as well, to get
more. Hold the microphone up near your mouth.
Yes. I like what David said about the churches. We could go to the churches to let people know what time. I like what he says, to text and apps. And I think we could improve more participants. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Lucy Cotine. I have a question. Why isn't it mandatory in our high schools for every student that turns 18 to be automatically registered to vote? It seems it would cost absolutely nothing, and the schools all know the birth dates of their students, so it could be done several ways. On the day that student is 18, they would go to a certain place and have help registering to vote, or their home teacher or the history teacher or somebody could help them after the class, or I'm sure it could be done in 100 different ways, but it should be mandatory and it would cost nothing. And that way, I don't know how many high school seniors turn 18 or juniors or whoever it is in the school year, but it must be a significant number. And if they should graduate at 17 or 16, then they should be sent off with a voter registration form to be turned in when they are 18. So that's a simple suggestion, not quite finished. Another very cheap thing you could do would be to have every student throughout K or pre-K or nursery, throughout senior, to be sent home with a note on primary day and on election day, or maybe the day before. The younger the child is, the more likely that the parent will see that note. And it could even be printed on the back of some other note that goes home, because I know the schools are not shy about sending notes home to parents. And it could tell the parent, tomorrow is primary day, don't forget to vote. And then you can have the child put pressure on their parent through those civic classes. It's going to be the children, just as they teach the parents about the importance of the environment and how to recycle, because they're taught that in school, the children could easily put that pressure, and the next day they're going to say, Mom, Dad, did you vote? Or big brother, big sister. It would cost zero. It would bring in thousands of people. But those are my ideas.
Just to touch base on some of the things you said, we are looking to expand into making sure that we do reach out to all the juniors and seniors. Our youth voter coordinator right now does do workshops throughout New York City high schools and middle schools. The workshops are that teaches them about how to be an engaged citizen and some civic engagement workshops, and then they get to go home and ask their parents to make sure they register to vote. And every senior does receive a voter registration form currently. And that's part of our outreach, making sure that we're out there in high schools, letting them know what this form means to them. And then back to the challenge where we talked about making sure that they're registered, but how can they understand that they're registered and now they have to go to the polls? So we're looking to make sure we continue those efforts and increase them. And this spring we'll be joining some of the League of Women Voters initiatives in some of those high schools.
Thank you.
that's, it would be great, and especially when kids go home and they give that note, the parents always open those. So.
Good morning. My name is O'Brien Murray. I'm here as a resident of New York City. I've been known to work on a few campaigns myself in the city, some of you may know me. I would just point out for the Lincoln voters a couple quick things. I do agree with you that this board erred incorrectly on the Lou decision on pulling funds at last minute especially. But the other point, you're talking about primary day. I think we have to be aware that there are two options in Albany, which your colleague on the panel mentioned too.
Right.
One is the August primary. And I think if the League of Women Voters picks one over the other, you're then playing the partisan world of which one is better. And I think there could be arguments on both sides. For instance, the reason that the Senate wants the August primary is because the Senate is in session up through that point. So do you want our senators up there voting and working on legislation like we elected them for, or do you want them back in the district's campaign for the election if it was a June primary? So that there's major issues there, and I just want to implore upon you, as much as this board, to be very careful about getting caught into the partisan decisions throughout any decisions you make and ideas that you want to put forward, that there are two sides to the arguments.
Right.
In that vein, the idea on the mobile phones, while noble, off the top of my head, I can think of about three reasons for it that don't work. Number one, there's about 16 million phone numbers for cell phones in New York City, nearly twice as many as the residents are. When you go beyond that, the voters that are registered that have cell phones are much less. So you're running into a whole issue on who you actually reach and turn out. I did a race for Bob Turner in Brooklyn and Queens a few years ago for the special election. And one of the issues we had in the Russian community was on Russian radio. You may have been aware of that because it was hearings in city council afterwards. Everybody was talking about the race, talking about the race. A significant number of voters showed up to vote that day and were turned away from the polls because they were not in the 9th Congressional District. So that you then reached out beyond the area where there was an election, which caused all kinds of lines at the polling locations. Additionally, you had people that were irate at the polling locations and said, wait, I came to vote, you're not letting me vote. So with that, Lou Fidler then had hearings at the city council because of that challenge. So while it's a noble idea to say, let's get everyone to vote and use the mobile phones, there's some major flaws there. The other thing is if everyone then gets a text, they're not registered to vote, and they start showing up at the polls, who's going to handle them at the polling sites when they show up, they're not registered, they have to go through affidavit ballots and so forth. So we have enough problems on election day with that, so be very careful with that. And the other little quick point on that comes up is if you're telling them to go vote on election day, but the campaigns, due to limited resources of time and money, have never contacted these voters with their messages, then they're really going out there to vote based upon either party affiliation or ethnicity or whatever it might be. So just to tell somebody to vote that has not been contacted or hasn't seen the papers, or I mean, a lot of these races don't have the opportunity to have the free media coverage that make them anywhere near educated on an issue. So it's very challenging to say, hey, everybody just go vote no matter what you think, without having known any of the issues. So I think we have to be very careful of that kind of situation. And if the board wants to address any of those, I'd be happy to hear them, legal women voters too. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your remarks. I'm sure you must be aware that until the mid-70s, we did have a June primary in New York State. And you might also be interested to know that you are in good company with respect to your position that June versus August is a partisan issue, and the New York City Board of Elections takes that position, and therefore they have no position with respect to, they will take no public position with respect to changing the primary, even though they are well aware of the kind of work it's involved for them to run several primaries over the course of the year.
One more question.
Yes, again, my name is David Kayode. When we talk of outreaching and to educate New Yorkers, there's segment of the people that is practically ignored. The homeless people in New York. At this time, we have about 50,000 homeless people that live in different shelters in the five boroughs of New York. Now, when it's time to vote election, they might be living in Atlantic Main Shelter today, tomorrow they are in Bellevue, The next day, they are in Kingsborough. So now, how can we involve? What can we do to let this neglected part of our people to be able to vote? Probably, wherever they are, when election come, can be their home, where they can vote. Because these people, they are part of us, they are citizens, they are American, and I think we should do something to include them in day-to-day of our life, to do something to be enable them to vote. So this is my question. What can we do to help the homeless New Yorker?
Last year, we partnered with Care for the Homeless, and we did a public service announcement where they had their community leaders and that hold workshops within that community, trying to educate them about voter registration and getting out to the polls and using the different shelters' addresses and so forth. So we did have a voter education campaign, letting them know what their rights are. It's a large community, so definitely, you know, we have more work to do. We did distribute about 15,000 voter registration forms through the Department of Homeless Services. So we're chipping away, but you're right, we still have a lot of work to continue within that, and we're always looking for new partners within the community to make sure that we reach those citizens.
If I remember, there was a there was litigation in the 80s about this. And the Board of Elections does not second guess someone's residence. If someone says, my residence is the park bench to the left of whatever, that is what is accepted as their residence.
Right, that's correct. But they have to vote from that park bench in whatever.
At the voting booth.
Well, so in that district, is that what you mean?
Whatever a voter says their residence is generally not second guessed, absent fraud.
Thank you,
panelists. Any other questions?
Am I allowed to address
the panel? Oh, sure. Yeah. I'd like to address your question, actually. It's a little late to the game, but better late than ever. So getting people to the polls in an informed way is obviously a really big challenge. And I can't say that anybody has any particular clues about exactly how to do that. But we have to try lots of things. And there's some interesting data points out there. Right now in the United States, over 60% of people have smartphones. Which means that over 60% of people have access to the internet via their phones, which is an astonishing number, especially when you consider that as compared to the past. And so when you look at that level of growth and you look to the future, it seems inevitable that that penetration rate will continue to go up. Now, with respect to New York City, we are, I think, the lowest, we're the last in last place in terms of smartphone penetration, with roughly about 50%. And that means that, and there's some reasons for that. We have a largely immigrant population. We have a large low-income population. And so there are folks who don't have access, but the growth rates remain pretty similar and pretty encouraging. Now, when you look at the people who actually do vote in the demographics by age and by race, certainly we'd like to see more participation by folks who are younger. I want to see more participation by folks who are minorities. And the data also, and the correlation between smartphone usage and these really valued demographics is really, really important. Among Asians in particular, John Liu intersection here of interest, about 80% of all Asians have a smartphone, which is astonishing. And when you look at folks who are 25 to 35, that demographic has about an 80% smartphone penetration rate as well. So they have access to the information. And so what we've tried to do is actually create the channels so that people can easily find the information they need to be informed voters as a whole. And so if you go to NYC Votes, you'll see, you know, our sort of early efforts, you know, for that, where you can find out who's on the ballot in your zip code, or based on your address, where to vote, how to vote, and see the information about each candidate that's reflected in the voter guide. Which may not be enough, but it is, I think, a pretty important first step. Now, the other thing that's very interesting, and is a huge frustration of ours, is when you look at the adoption rates for other technologies out there and what consumers are doing on these phones, you realize that the competition for time on phones is very, very high. The information does exist, it becomes more convenient all the time, but the competition is super, super high. And so the question that I would pose to us as a government agency in this very critical role, but also to the people, is how do we start to leverage some of those mechanics that we see out there enjoyed by consumer-facing technologies? And I'll just use the example of Flappy Bird. I don't know how many of you have seen Flappy Bird. Flappy Bird went from a position of being introduced in the iTunes App Store in May of last year. And as of last month, it was on 50 million phones globally. And people were writing about their addiction to Flappy Bird. It's been withdrawn because the developer felt like he was doing a disservice to the people of the world by having this highly addictive, useless product on the market. But the fact is that people do have, obviously, a very, very close affinity to their phones, whether for entertainment or for information. And an increasing amount of information and actually commerce is being enjoyed on these devices. So the question is, I think, to me, is not whether we should be doing it or not, but what should we be doing to really help bring the attention to elections in a way that's very interesting. So I find, you know, Mr. Davis's proposal to make it on the equivalent. It's a very, very interesting idea.
And how do we build these psychic rewards into our apps that Flapping Birds did?
Correct.
And, you know, I do a lot of emergency management, emergency planning education, and there's a, I use an older technology of log to post all kinds of information for Jewish institutions. And I posted something just in basic, after Sandy, basic education on, you know, have a plan, have a go-get, those kind of things. But I used an award-winning series of YouTubes from Kansas. They were brilliant. And what I found is people, once they watched the first one, they wanted to watch the second one. They wanted to watch the third because of the content. It was giving all the right information, but it was doing it in a way that rewarded people, was entertaining, and people felt it was worth their time. And we have to start concentrating on voting in exactly that way.
So maybe a Khan Academy, of civics?
I think one of the things the commission has to be aware of is how the campaigns operate too, and the laws we have to operate under. We cannot just blindly contact people on our cell phones and those mobile devices easily, which means that if we can't contact them there and you can, there's a major outcome on the election you have an impact on. And where I would go to that is in something called a blind poll. And I'll not go into it in great detail. I can go at some other point if you want, because I know we're stressed on time here. But basically the idea on a campaign is, if anybody I know is my person going to support me, whether you're Democrat, Republican, Independent, I put them on the side. I don't reach out to them until towards election day. I focus on the people that I can try to swing my way, the independents, the opposition party that can swing my way, and then identify them and bring them out to vote. That blind poll segment is something that I then have resources to reach after, you know, as you get close to the election, to turn them out. If one party or another knows that the campaign finance board is going to do a blind poll to all voters, which then gives X number of voters contacts to say go out and vote without a contact, that will skew elections dramatically, who shows up, and what happens. And I think that's what I'm saying about an informed voter, that if a campaign cannot, doesn't have the resource of time or money to contact certain voters, and then this board steps up and just blind polls people to come vote, that's a major issue. If you have opportunities to give them information and they actually look at the information, that may be a slightly different issue. But if you send emails, they don't open them and read the information, and then you say, come out and vote, that's going to have a major impact on certain outcomes of elections, especially charter elections.
Well, I must say, there I don't have sympathy for you, because if the notion is that campaigns only want their voters to vote, that's one of the problems we have. We got to figure out a way to get more voters to vote and not have just these targeted campaigns that ignore the broader body. So probably this isn't the place for that debate, but I understand your first points. I just want to be clear on that one. I respectfully disagree.
Hi, thank you. My name is Jane Colvin. I'm also a member of the League of Women Voters of New York City. Thank you very much for doing this. I just wanted to pick up on the idea of content and turn Marshall McLuhan, or give him a new spin. We have so many media at this point to get messages out that I think we should be focusing on content. And it's not only the psychic reward, or again, maybe it's a corollary to your voter efficacy. It's what's in it for me, it seems to me, motivates most people's action. And I have a feeling if people had some idea of the importance of their vote and how it affected their daily lives, it might work. It might motivate them to take a step. This would obviously require 140 characters of tweet or a Cooney video, which would demonstrate what is impacted by, you know, by their vote, how it affects their lives, how it affects what they do.
I think we'll take a 2-minute break, and then we'll have our open public testimony. So people who had issues that weren't addressed here, you're welcome to testify in the public testimony and bring up those issues during that time. Thank you.
Thank you, Kate.